right, welcome everybody. Mil-Spec Ops Monkey here. This is going to be your sit rep for December 13th, 2021. It's about 4 p.m. Central Time, coming to you from the great state of Texas. And so without further ado, make sure you hit that like, subscribe, and bell for notification. As we jump on over to the board, looking at the numbers right now, we're showing up about 372. It's been kind of a heavy day, actually. Mil aircraft total around the world, 646. Again, you only see about 10% of what's really up. Mast aircraft about 98. And so most of ours that you're seeing on there in that cluster between Texas and Florida, as always, is gonna be the trainers. We've got about 92 trainers up right now, sitting at about 25 heavy movers, heavy lifters, should I say, up. That's C-130s, C-5s, C-17s, et cetera. I'm going to bounce over real fast. It looks like we're sitting kind of low on tankers right now, just sitting at four KC-135s and one DC-10. And let me see if we've got any 6-7s up, but it doesn't. Yeah, just one. So we got like six air refuelers up, which is a really, really low number. This is what it looked like this morning. So we just kind of bounce over just a couple hours ago. If you look at the U.S. tankers that were up, just in the southeast alone, there's quite a few. They were actually very, very active early this morning. Looks like maybe they're all down on the ground. Maybe they'll bump back up here in a little bit. But that was this morning in terms of air refuelers, which, again, that was pretty heavy. If we looked at this morning in terms of, let me get over here to the sub hunters, we also had quite a few P-8s, Navy P-8s that were up. Those are sub hunters. Just a surge coming out of Jacksonville again. We've been seeing this actually now for a couple weeks, and of course they go all over the East Coast and down into the Gulf of Mexico. And so kind of an interesting data point there. We'll continue to watch those and see, but they were off of Jacksonville and Cape Canaveral area running routes. So typically when those are down, we see you're going to have that'll be tied to, you know, submarine activity that's off the coast, either enemy, you know, friend or foe. They're looking at both. They can communicate with ours, but they're looking for others. That's kind of how those work. Now, in terms of the heavy lifts this morning, check this out. This was actually kind of a surge early this morning. We did have a lot of three ships. You can see two and three ships rolling out there in the central U.S., headed westbound and all up the East Coast. That was kind of the routine for this morning. Now, I will tell you, over the weekend, one data point I thought was really interesting is I watched a ton of air refuelers roll out of the U.S. over to Hawaii, on over to Asia. And so I'm also seeing some more activity, and we'll touch on that here in just a second. We've got one of the senior, I don't know if they're part of the defense committee or what they are on, but they're also headed out there. It looks like they're headed to Japan, but in that general area. Now, let me minimize this for a minute. This is going to be your flat map. Again, we just looked at all that data. We'll come back to that in a second. If we look over here at flashbang schedule, just so you guys can see, for the 13th today, he's getting together, I guess, for the tornadoes that took place on Friday night across multiple states. And then this one I thought was kind of an interesting. So he's meeting with FEMA. Then you got down here to this executive order that he's signing on delivering the government services and experiences the American people expect and deserve. And so I kind of think it's probably going to be looking a little bit like this right here. It's a little humor for you. I don't think he can deliver anything that we're going to actually deserve as long as he's in office. So once he unseats that location and we get Trump back in there, I think things will look a little bit rosier. So speaking of non-rosy, we're over here on the marine side. You know, speaking of Build Back Better, this is the port of Los Angeles. We've been looking at this about every sit rep. And as you can see, it's still pretty racked and stacked in here. We do have a couple boats that are moving out. That means they just got unloaded. But all these in here are actually waiting to be unloaded. So doesn't look to be getting any better, maybe a little bit. And I imagine there's a big push right now because of Christmas, because if people don't get all that inventory on the shelves and out the doors to people, it's going to not be a good Christmas for the retailers. Okay. All right. Let's pop over here real fast on TFRs. Take a look at what's going on. Not too much, actually. We do have some activity. That's a security TFR out of Jacksonville. Then we got our regular one here. It doesn't look like Flashbang is doing any traveling anytime soon. Everything else looks to be pretty normal operations in terms of that. Now, this one is new. Let me see what that is outside of a gale warning. So another security one there. So it looks like the Navy may be actually doing a little bit of a pulse on some exercises, because we've got some stuff going on there security wise down in California and then also in the Jacksonville area. And there is that. And so let me back up, get away from that. Now, speaking of the Navy, let's get over here to Guantanamo Bay. Activity going on. We had some arrivals today coming in from Norfolk. That was a 767-300. Looks like that Amerijet actually rolled back, departed back to Norfolk. So it was just a round trip. And then, of course, we have these scheduled at 773RB. That's one of our new aircraft that's kind of coming in on Tuesday, Friday schedule right now. And then we've got this United Airlines that's coming in from Jacksonville. Now, it should be noted, we do have this activity going on right now with Al-Rahim Hussein Muhammad Abdu Al-Nasiri. And that's a mouthful, isn't it? Anyway. But that ends this Friday on the 17th. So once that is done, I don't see anything else on the calendar the rest of the year. So we'll have to keep a close eye on that activity to see if we continue to see things spark. And then that means there's obviously something else going on besides this thing here. Okay. All right. So looking at some of the Gitmo birds, we are sitting, let's see, this is 301 AZ. This is kind of a regular. Rolled out of Orlando up here to Fort Worth. That's Alliance. Today landed about 1:16 p.m. That's in right there in kind of North Texas. DFW Airport is right here on your map. And so that's Alliance. That's a Ross Perot area. Okay. And so if you look back, this thing kicked off early morning in Opa-locka. We know all about that location. Up to Augusta, then from there over to O-Town, then from Orlando up to Alliance. So it's been bouncing around quite a bit just today alone. Now, 302 AZ, if we look at this, this one is actually up in Chicago, landed 2 hours, 40 minutes ago, bounced from Chicago over to Michigan. And again, we haven't seen these guys bounce in and out of the spot lately, but they are definitely still kind of in that circulation. And then, of course, N173PA, this is actually one. We were talking a minute ago about all of these flights that have been going out to Japan and Asia Pacific. All the air refuelers that went out, which means probably a lot of fighters. Seems to be some type of activity going on or a surge. Could be an exercise. But this one here is actually out at Majuro and was headed over to Guam from there. Now, those not familiar with Majuro, this right here on your map is Kwajalein Atoll. That's out there in the South Pacific. You used to have done a lot of surfing there and used to live out there for a year. So I'm very familiar with that area. Now, Majuro is one of the little stops bumped in, headed over to Guam. And then from Guam, you'll see them head into somewhere here in Southeast Asia or over up to Japan. Just kind of depends. Typically, the Japan routes come over the arc. But it originated out of Sacramento, and we have seen that before. So we'll probably hear some details about some dignitary going over there for some kind of event that's happening or an exercise. Okay. All right. C-202, this bad dude rolled out of Kentucky where the storms were on, and that happened on Sunday, up back to D.C. Looked like it was kind of a quick round robin. Probably was told to go there, but Barclay Regional and back round trip all on Sunday. All right. Now, let's just take a look. I wanted to see if the sniffer had done anything new since the last time we got together. Doesn't look like it has. It looks to be still in Camp Springs, which is the brown zone. All right. And so we'll watch this. I always have my pulse on this one because anytime they're out sniffing the air, that tells you there's some type of a threat for the most part. We just never hear about it, okay? And again, that one has been spending a lot of time in Philadelphia, and I mean almost 30 days it was over there looking at stuff. All right, another spy plane, R50348. This is an army bird that actually rolls out off the coast of Jersey and Delaware, kind of run. This is, it originates out of the DC, Washington DC, and then runs this little route and does it pretty regularly. Knowing that we've got a lot of poppies up here in Jersey, and Delaware is obviously the home of flashbang, and so I can see them, why they would be, you know, very interested in that area as well. Now, over the weekend, we actually had a balloon spotting, and I just want to point this one out because it just popped on and now it has since disappeared, but it was last seen near St. Augustine, Florida, and it rolled out. It was originated up here in Sioux Falls, as you guys know. Sioux Falls is actually Raven Aerospace. They're the ones that launched this thing. And what they do is they put it up in the air and then the military takes it over. And so that's why we see it and then we don't see it. Okay, so all tied to military spying programs. And so now it's off the coast right here, and that's where we lost sight of it. No telling where it's headed, what it's doing, but it is up at, let me see what the last, it's not giving me altitude, just gives me distance. So last I saw it was kind of in the Brunswick, Georgia area, and that thing was up at about 62,000 feet. So I would imagine it's still up there at that altitude. So. Okay, now the fun stuff. This is one thing that we want to talk about. I get asked this question all the time, and I mean it's either in the chats or somebody's bouncing with something talking about this stuff. And so one of the things I wanted to do was kind of go through the basics of the difference between chemtrail and contrail, because they are often confused. You'll see a lot of people that'll talk about, you know, the sky has all these chemtrails all over it, and they're really contrails. So what I wanted to do was kind of go through this and just show you, not saying chemtrails don't exist. We're going to talk on that as well, because they do. But I just want to show you the difference so that every time you see, you know, a plane blowing, you know, what it looks like to be chemicals across your sky, you're not in paranoia thinking, you know, some paranoid state thinking that we are being, you know, just inundated with chemicals. So. Okay, so let's talk first about chemtrails. This is what a chemtrail looks like. Now, what you're going to notice there are four trails and there are four engines, okay? Now, the reason for that is because the air where that thing is hitting is moist, okay, and it'll create a cloud behind it. It's really all it is. But that jet engine exhaust comes out around 2,500 degrees Fahrenheit. And the inlet that's being pulled in is sitting at, negative 45 degrees. So when it hits that heat and then gets burst into that moist environment, it actually creates a cloud, okay? And so that's what you're seeing is this thing generating. So the way an engine works, think of it as this. Suck, squeeze, bang, and blow, okay? The air gets sucked into the front. It gets squeezed by the compressor. The bang takes place in the igniter ignition area, right? And so all of that gas that's compressed gets ignited and then it gets blown out of the back, creating thrust. And so those black blades you see are called fans and they are massive. And then on the inside are the little fan blades, okay? Now those things, like I said, it sucks in that super cold air. And as it goes out the back, it is super, talking 2,500 degrees Fahrenheit, which is super duper hot, okay? So when you see that, what you typically see are contrails, okay? Now, there is a thing, and one of the things I want to tell you is called cloud seeding, which is really, it is a chemtrail, okay? When you see the process of it, it's exactly what they're doing. It's basically creating a chemtrail. Very similar in nature, although they're calling it a different thing. It is indeed putting chemicals into our sky, okay? This is called cloud seeding. It's a pyrotechnic flare that they bounce off the back of these aircraft with these little launch tubes into the clouds, and they create rain. They make it rain, okay? But these things are used for other purposes. And so this is another one that's actually alive. You can see these releases popping into the sky. And so that is cloud seeding. And we've got governments that actually talk about doing it. You've got China actually used seeds in the cloud to make sunshine on the Communist Party Day celebration. All right. And so they have that type of event going on. And then, of course, we have whistleblowers that come forward. Like this one, Kristen Megan talks about military chemtrails. She knows because she was in the U.S. Air Force. She talks about how she witnessed them putting canisters of fine powdered aluminum and barium into the atmosphere after they were loaded onto jets. And so they're basically saying how they were injecting this aluminum and barium into the jet engines and pushing it out. It's an environment that will, I mean, you get those jet engines that are already going to create that cloud, so to speak. And so when you're seeing this, that is, it could be a chemtrail, could be a contrail, but most of the time you're going to see this contrail. All right. And so, that's why I say when you see 99.9% of the time, this right here, that is going to be contrails. There are 10,000 airplanes up at, on any given day, and most of them are going to have, when they hit it, that moist environment, are going to produce that. Now, there are times, I will tell you myself, when I've looked up at the sky and thought, there's definitely a difference. I mean, these contrails don't go away. They stick around for a long period of time. Then the sky gets super hazy. And times when I've seen that and I go to look up the flights, and I'm looking on my apps and I can't find that aircraft. It's just zinging across and there's nothing tracking it. Is that a chemtrail? Maybe, could very well be. How often and frequently does that happen? I don't really know. I just, I know that most of the time what we're seeing are contrails, but they do happen. I'm not saying they don't, okay, by any means. When you got people coming in, whistleblowers, that are telling you about it, hands-on, did it, and this whole geoengineering thing, it's hard to dispute that, okay? And so, but like I said, it just depends. It's a matter of, in order to catch it and to find it, you have to A, have eyes on it, and B, you gotta have an app to where you can actually see them doing it. Like looking at a needle in a haystack. So. Are they doing it to us? I'm convinced, no doubt in my mind, that they're doing it to us. But most of the time, what we're looking at are actually contrails, not chemtrails. Okay. Okay. So get off of that touchy subject. On to another one. Now, this is one. If you remember back during the debates, there was some talk about dark winter. This was actually something that Flashbang talked about, and so I'm going to cut to this real fast. Listen to what he says, and I'm going to point at a couple things, okay? It's really interesting. Is it a coincidence? Probably not. But I discovered something over the weekend looking through one of the government sites after one of the Monkey Nation folks reached out to me and told me that this was out there. And so I, as always, to find the truth, was digging down in and found this information. And it's a little bit disturbing, a little alarming. So here it is. Remember this.
Going to a dark winter, and he has no clear plan, and there's no prospect that.
And so there's a need for bold action to fight this pandemic. We're still facing a very dark winter. There are now nearly 10.
Okay. Now, he has said that many, many times, not just those two times, okay? But those were two. I just went out and got some data sources. So you could see he keeps referencing this thing called dark winter. Now, here's the other thing, too. If you have not seen this, this is actually a study done by John Hopkins that was conducted back in 2001 called Dark Winter. It walks you through the synopsis, the overview of it. It took place at Andrews Air Force Base in Washington, D.C., June 22nd and 23rd of 2001. And then, of course, there are all these PFs that walk you through the whole synopsis. I can save you a little bit of that time just to tell you What they do is they basically look at how smallpox would be introduced in an environment like we have today relative to air travel, okay? And so they wanted to see if it were introduced, given a 14-day incubation period, and the fact that nobody has been immunized since 1970, where does this, you know, how does it spread? How quickly does it spread? What's the mortality rates? How many people die? All that kind of stuff. Very similar modeling to what you saw with the event 201 or whatever it was, right? And so, but this is John Hopkins, you know, they do these kind of studies quite frequently. And so this is one called Dark Winter, all right? Now, here's what got my attention I thought was really interesting, and I just want to point this one out. This actually went out to the website for government bids and contracts, and this one is out there. Now, this is, if you look at it closely, this is, let me just see if I can get it. Actually, let me back out of that part. Okay, sorry, I'm on the backside looking at my scenes. But this is actually a description, gives you kind of an overview of what they're trying to do, where they're going to operate it. The due date for getting this, it's a smallpox antiviral that they're trying to get by December 14, 2021, at least the open bid. It's going to be sole sourced through a company called Chimerix Incorporated. And it's, like I said, it's out there. It was updated November 29th, 2021. So for them to be looking for a source and an antiviral, my understanding is that they were trying to procure 280 million of these things. Now, if you know how many people are in the US, I wanna say that number is closer to 340 million citizens in the US. So why the number is below the citizen rate, I don't know. That's a little bit alarming. But this, it looks to be a valid bid and a valid concern. And so we need to be paying close attention to that, because smallpox, I will tell you, is nothing to fool around with. Its kill rate's pretty high. And it's kind of like Ebola. If it gets you, your survival rate or chance of survival is not very good, okay? All right, so I want to point that out. Let's bounce back over here to the board real fast on ADSB Exchange. Just take a look at what's going on right now in the skies. We do have a couple sentries up. Running routes, that is out kind of the southeast Oklahoma. That looks to be a marshalling pattern more so than a grab data pattern, but they are wearing that one out. That looks to be a lot of tracks, a lot of hang time. All right. Those not familiar, a sentry is, it's like an air traffic control, airborne air traffic control, but they have the ability to do tower grabs, okay? And grab things like cell data, et cetera. So, all right, this is another one. You can see this one here. Now, note those tight circles, that's a data grab. Note the difference between that one and the one we just looked at. When they start running that tight circle, they are becoming man in the middle. That is a data, they're grabbing cell tower data typically. That is south of Roswell, New Mexico. Okay, Carlsbad here, Roswell up here. So there is one of the sentries. And then that is a normal kind of a sentry route that you would see kind of just hit that, what they call a marshalling pattern, maintain altitude, and they just kind of fly that route and work congestion and things of that nature. So that's the difference between the two. So when you see these kind of routes, what you have to really look at are altitude. If you see a route like that and it's low, like this line is orange in here, then they're more than likely doing touch and goes at an airport. If you see one that's high altitude like this one, 30,000 feet, and just maintaining and doing that marshalling pattern, they're probably working air traffic control congestion for probably the fighters and stuff that are in these two areas. Note they're directly between both cells of air traffic, okay? So, and these are all trainers, as are these. This is all trainers coming out of Del Rio down here. And then of course you get them down here in San Antonio, and then the Navy and Coast Guard do stuff down here in Corpus, okay? So, looks like we got a couple sentries. That looks to be, that's Husker 15. That's an air refueler. Now, remember I was talking about these marshalling patterns where they're just kind of doing those routes. And the orange lines, that's doing touch and goes, okay? So there is that. Like I said, not a lot of tankers up right now, which is really kind of strange. We typically see a lot. We have not been seeing them as much today. They started out heavy and then they kind of subsided. You do have a tanker out here in the middle of nowhere headed southbound. Looks like it's headed down to Puerto Rico. And a couple of C-17s airborne, another tanker. Let me see if that one just took off. So, okay. Well, that is, let me just kind of bounce around and take a look what's going on. We got any traffic out here in Hawaii. Looks like Australia's got a handful of aircraft up. Let me kind of zing in here and see. That's a P-8, so that's a Navy sub-hunter over land. And then this one here looks like a little 737. That's kind of like their Marine Corps. Note the same paint jobs as you get on ours. These don't have any special, stuff on them, you know, for doing spy stuff. So that just looks like a normal transport for the Australian Royal Air Force. These are trainers down here in the bottom, okay? All right. Well, let me see. My screen seems to have locked up on me. All right, there we go. Maybe not. Okay. So let me get over here. Little King Air. That's a B-350 out here in New Zealand. Everything else looks to be kind of, let's see if these are black. Let me see. No, they're not. Okay. Let's see, just a little two ship flying, kind of quiet really, for 4:30. I guess over here it's pushing 10, 11 p.m. Over here probably closer to midnight. So, all right, well listen, we'll continue to keep our eye on that. Again, we'll watch over in Japan in that area to see if there is some kind of naval exercise going on. Like I said, we had a lot of aircraft that bounced out to Hawaii and then over to Southeast Asia. And then upwards and kind of between two locations, between Japan and Southeast Asia. So that was just something we need to probably keep our eyes on, given that Taiwan is looking to be a little bit of a hot spot, as is Ukraine. So that'll be our sit rep for today. So we'll see you back here on Wednesday. You guys be safe out there. Stay frosty. God bless. Monkey out.
Check out the latest gear and products at MonkeyWorksUS.com.